Good morning. Welcome to WEP On Air. To our Facebook audience, welcome, and please leave your comments below. My name is Nicholas DeMille. I'm the head of University Editorial Services here at KAUST. And today I have the honor of speaking with Steph Davis. She's a rock climber, an author, and a wingsuit pilot. I think I have that correct. So Steph, tell us, most people look at a cliff and they leave it be. You climb it and or jump off of it or both at the same time. Tell us what motivates you to do that.
It's funny because people always ask that. They say, why do you climb and why do you jump? It's not something I really question that much. I guess I've been doing it for so long. It's, you know, eating, running, it's just a thing you do. But I think it's really about adventure and about the experience and just kind of understanding landscapes, you know, both physical and internal. So there are a lot of things that are very appealing about doing something like that.
Mm-hmm. How do you know when you get up on the day of a climb or a jump, how do you know you'll be able to do it?
Well, a good part of it is the unknown, where you can either prepare yourself in advance or prepare yourself specifically for a certain objective. But I think the reason that we do try to do things that are difficult is because there is always that slight question of if it's possible for you, and that's what we're trying to find out.
So both of these activities, either going up or coming down, are fraught with some form of risk. How do you know when to take risks and when not to take risks?
I think that is what is most interesting about what I call high commitment activities. And, you know, that can be anything. Doesn't have to be climbing, doesn't have to be base jumping, but we're dealing with this stuff all our lives. Mm-hmm. And what's really interesting is to get better at it over time and just become a better risk manager. And so that requires a lot of honesty with yourself and the ability to really objectively analyze a situation, an environment, and your place in that situation. And if you are able to do that, usually you can get the answers of, you know, am I ready to be here? Do I belong here? Or do I need to leave? Am I not quite prepared enough for this? Or should I give it a try today?
You talk pretty eloquently about the distinction between fear and intensity. Can you elaborate on that?
Yeah, I think fear is, you know, it's so interesting for us because we are so controlled by fear as humans. I think it's the thing that controls us more than anything. So, you know, something we're all dealing with all the time. And I think about it a lot. You know, I deal with fear a lot. That's one of the reasons that I do the things I do, to kind of have this little training ground for dealing with these things. And what I have found for myself over time is that I think we tend to be very reactive to feelings that we identify as fear, but I think that we aren't always very specific with those feelings. So if we feel anything, we might just think, oh, I'm scared and want to react and often leave, mm-hmm. or maybe overreact and, you know, push too hard. But what's interesting, if you kind of pick that stuff apart with yourself, is that there's different shades of those feelings. So for example, a lot of times the feeling is what I call intensity, where you kind of have all those physical feelings inside, you know, whether you feel a little tight inside or anxious, and then all the physical reactions that you get. Mm-hmm. But sometimes that's just intensity. You know, that's something that you want to be feeling. That's why you are pushing yourself or going for a new experience or kind of stepping out of your comfort zone. So that's not necessarily something that we need to like back off right away. Mm-hmm. But it takes a little patience, because if you don't make a practice of this, as soon as you feel anything like that, you might have a habit of just trying to get away from it.
Mm-hmm. So that leads me to You also talk about the difference between endurance and resilience, and you've had to endure some short and long-term things in your career. Talk a little bit about that difference as well.
Yeah, that's something that I've learned about, you know, as with everything I've learned about, I feel like, in life, in the mountains. When you climb in the mountains, a lot of times, it's a pretty long thing. You know, you can be out for 36 hours sometimes just going up and trying to get back down. And so that really teaches you about enduring and just kind of getting through it. And what I've learned in experiences like that is that you don't really have space for a lot of emotion and a lot of lightness, because you just have to go until it's over and you got to kind of turn off the emotion. When I've applied that to life experiences, when things have been difficult in life, what I've gradually learned over time is that that is a good way to kind of get through things when they're really difficult, but it's not a good way to be in life, because, you know, what makes life so great are those emotions of happiness and fun and joy and, you know, hope for things. And so if you just kind of shut them all off and just slog through it, it'll keep you going for a while, but the real goal is to be able to kind of be light and bounce back and not just be slogging all the time.
Do you think that some of the jumping aspects of your job come from an escapism, or do you intensely stay in the moment with that? You explain a little bit in your book how you always imagined falling as a climber, but it took skydiving for you to really explore how in touch with what's happening you are. Talk a little bit about when you jump, how intensely there you are.
Well, base jumping, skydiving, any kind of parachuting, flying, it's very mental and very emotional, because, you know, everybody sees that kind of imagery or kind of imagines what it feels like, and the first thing everybody thinks about is fear, because as humans we're so ingrained that we don't want to fall off of high places, which is very practical and right. legitimate of a survival instinct,
right.
But it's so strong that it's hard for people to even understand why you would want to be in the air, and so that's often where most people come at it. But when you have flown, you don't really question why you'd want to do that after that, because you're flying, and it's a really incredible thing to be able to do as a person. We don't have wings, so it's not a normal place that humans get to be, is flying in the air.
Right.
And so I think once you can get past that that kind of first feeling of resistance to the idea that it's a really amazing world to get to explore. Yesterday I got to go snorkeling over the coral reef, and you know, it was a really similar experience, just seeing the reef and the fish and the colors, and it's just this whole world that usually we don't get to see and we don't get to be in. But you know, if we can kind of take that step and put ourselves in a different place and do it the right way with the right equipment, it's really phenomenal to get to be there.
So one of the things that you're known for, and the internet is full of videos of you doing it, is being a wingsuit pilot. Talk a little bit about what a wingsuit is, and tell me, is it more guts than talent, or more talent than guts using one of these?
Well, parachuting is a pretty broad activity. There's skydiving, where you go jump out of an airplane. I think a lot of people have done a skydive. And then you can take that to base jumping, where instead of an airplane, you jump off a cliff or a building or a bridge or something like that. A wingsuit is a tool that has been developed, honestly, over hundreds of years, because people have been wanting to do this since Leonardo da Vinci was making drawings about it. But basically nowadays, it's a nylon suit. It's like a superhero suit or a squirrel suit, call it a lot of different things. but you have all this fabric between your arms and between your legs, and the idea is to create more surface area so that when you fall, it turns some of that downward momentum into forward momentum. Mm-hmm. And so you glide for much further and you have maneuverability, mm-hmm. like a glider or an aircraft, mm-hmm. Or a bird. Mm-hmm. So you're always going down, but the idea is that you're going forward now instead of only down, and then you have maneuverability. Mm-hmm. So that really changes things, because without a wingsuit, you simply are just falling down in the air.
So again, the question for most of us, I think, that see this and really try to imagine what the sensation is. You jump, you have a second or two to reach critical velocity, mm-hmm. and then it starts to kick you forward. Mm-hmm. Talk about that experience, particularly the first time that you do it, seeing the ground, seeing things. What is that like?
It is really intense. The progression with wingsuiting is that it's a long progression. Mm. First, you get trained up and you become a skydiver. Mm. And then after you've done 200 skydives, you could get a wingsuit and start skydiving with that wingsuit. Meanwhile, you could also get trained up to be a base jumper without a wingsuit and then become expert at that. Mm. And then at some point, you make the decision, okay, it's time for me to fly my wingsuit off this cliff now. So
the guys that are taking on these mountain passes, they've been doing this for a while. It's not just somebody who's crazy enough to jump and do this.
You know, I mean, you do see some of that is not regulated. Uh-huh. And so we do have that happen where people are not quite ready, and they're just going to go try because they think they're ready. So we see that quite a bit. But generally speaking, yeah, it's a long road to get to the point where you are going to be flying a wingsuit off a cliff. And so, you know, it requires experience. It requires a lot of skill. And then, yeah, it does require that level of confidence to finally stand at the edge of the cliff and say, I'm going to jump off this cliff and fly my wingsuit. Right. And I think I can pull it off. Basically.
I think the perception is probably of people, and I don't want to paint with too broad a brush, but people that would do this are tremendous risk takers, mm-hmm. but you seem actually to be a very measured, very prepared person in the way that you do this. Talk about your process for getting ready for one of these jumps, let's say.
Yeah, I mean, like I said, I think a huge part of the attraction of flying wingsuits for myself and for a lot of pilots is just that it's really interesting to be a risk manager. Mm-hmm. And so that is definitely part of the process, is having all of this background experience and, you know, taking the steps to be at the point where you feel like this is a thing that you do. Mm-hmm. And then every time you jump, it is a process of decision making and risk management. You have to evaluate the conditions, talking about wind and temperature, anything like clouds, you know, upcoming conditions, because you're usually walking up a mountain, so this doesn't all happen like in 1 minute, you know. It's a long, drawn out, multi-hour experience. And then you have to evaluate the site. Sometimes you really don't know what that jump is like until you do go up the mountain for 4 hours. Mm-hmm. And so you have to be prepared to evaluate what you see when you get there. You also have to be prepared to go back down if you don't like it. Mm-hmm. And then you also have to evaluate where you're at, because a lot of different things can be going on for each person. Mm-hmm. You could be really exhausted from the climb. You could be not feeling good. You could be cold. You could be worried about things, who knows what. So. Mm-hmm. When you are ready to jump, there's kind of a lot at play that you have to decide, is this a good jump for me to do right now? And then, of course, there's evaluating the line you want to take, kind of like you talked about when you're flying around things, and then evaluating where you're going to land the parachute when you're done flying. And what's interesting, too, is typically the conditions of where you're going to land with your parachute are not going to be the same as where you jump off the cliff, because you could fly out, you know, a good mile or so. And so you're just sort of trying to guess based on clues at that point, you know, weather forecasts, things you can see in the distance, like water or smoke or, you know, anything like that. So there's definitely a lot going on that you have to decide before you ever decide you're jumping. And then once you do jump, then you're kind of in it and you're dealing with all of it.
Right. How long does a typical, and I know that mountains vary in their size, but how long does a typical flight take?
Well, I mean, the whole experience is, again, I think that the actual jumping part is so kind of wow that that's what people focus on, but the experience is not just the flight. The experience is climbing the mountain first.
Right.
That's where it starts.
Right.
So that can be generally 3 or 4 hours, depending on the height. And then, so you kind of have that whole part of it. And then at the top, there's the whole getting ready and deciding things part. That's usually a good half hour, maybe more. And then when you finally do go to fly, depending on the height, you could have maybe a 1 to 2 minute wingsuit flight and then pull your parachute out and get maybe another minute under parachute.
And how do you, I mean, a number of the flights that I've seen have people going over arms of a mountain or past a, you know, a feature, a standing rock or something. I mean, how do you visually know, yes, I can make that, I can't make that, I bail out to the left or right? I mean, how do you make those judgments? Do you look up the distances beforehand so you have a sense for the geography? Or tell me a little bit about that.
That's a really good question, and that's part of the progression of wingsuit flying. I've been flying wingsuits for 10 years. So when I started, the suits were much smaller and they weren't as good. And so every time you went to do a flight, you were really just wondering, how far am I gonna make it? It was really intimidating. Over the years, the suits have gotten better and better and better. We're kind of in a golden age right now. And so we have a much better tool. With the current wingsuits, most jumps that you're gonna do, you know you have enough glide to get out there. And so you start making decisions about how much you want to dive to things, and that's what makes it safer. And people do all sorts of stuff for new sites. There's a lot of Google Earth being used, different measurements. We kind of know what the suits do, so if we can figure out different elevations of formations, we can kind of get an idea before we go. And a lot of it too is trying to do different jumps on the same site. So when you first go to a new site, maybe you're not gonna take that line that you're not quite sure about. Maybe you're gonna do what we call a scouting jump, where you're gonna fly a little higher, a little wider, always making sure that you have outs where you could turn out and get over bigger air. So it can take a lot of jumps before people will do some of those more extreme lines that you've seen.
Yeah, through the gullies and things in particular, which seem insane.
Yeah, but you know, it looks really insane, but like I say, typically that's the result of many, many jumps at the same site.
I see. Maybe one of the biggest jumps, it seems, that all professional climbers seem to make is moving into their car and fully committing to a particular lifestyle. Talk a little bit about how you made that leap.
Yeah, well, it's funny too, because things have changed. I think there's so many more climbers nowadays. It's so much more mainstream. So we still have that going on. But I started climbing 25 years ago, and that's what you did. If you really wanted to dedicate yourself to climbing, you just worked a little bit, lived out of your car, and just climbed as much as you could. We didn't have all the climbing gyms like there are now. So you really just kind of had to go out there and be in it.
Right.
But you know, it's still going on. It's definitely a big part of climbing.
Right.
You need a lot of time to climb.
Right. So what is the business model in general that makes this possible? I think that's the other thing that's hard for people to imagine. I'm sure you get a lot of questions. You climb up and down hills for a living. How on earth do you make this feed you and house you and everything else?
It's very non-traditional. Right. And again, you know, the landscape has changed a ton since I started climbing. You know, 25 years ago, the outdoor industry was not where it's at right now. And it has grown quite a bit. So when I started climbing, there really wasn't a path to look towards to say, I would like to make a living at this. I think nowadays it's different for people. And there are a lot more opportunities for sponsorship. Still, it's by no means golf or football. There's not the kind of budget available. And it's just not quite at that level. But but it does exist. So for myself, I make my living primarily through sponsorships, working with different companies. And basically, you know, climbing itself is inherently not very useful to anyone. So what I have learned over the years is I need to find a way to create value and to be of use to people. And so me going climbing by myself is not useful, but me going climbing and sharing that with people in such a way that it's either inspiring or helpful or community building, then that has value. And so I work very hard on keeping my platforms relevant and accessible to people, and then that is something that companies find valuable and would like to be attached to. So that's primarily how I do it. I think everybody's a little bit different. There's not really a path or a single model for people. But that's what works for me, and it's really fulfilling for me too.
You're also an author. I've seen two of your books. How did that aspect of your career come about?
I have a master's in literature and taught writing as a part of that. And so I've always written, I've always been a writer. And when I was a young climber, I was always just writing stories about my experiences traveling. And at one point I thought, well, there's enough stories, maybe I can make a book, because I hadn't done it before. And so the first book was just kind of to experience what it would be like to do a book, basically. And then the second one I wrote was really start to finish, you know, creating a single narrative memoir, which was definitely a bigger project. But having done the first one, it felt like I understood the process a little bit better. And so, yeah, I guess, you know, writing's just something I do.
Right. You were an English major as an undergrad. Okay. And you somewhat famously, by your saying, did a week in law school as well.
Yeah.
You didn't want to be that type of risk manager. You wanted to manage different types of risk.
Well, part of risk management is knowing when to cut your losses.
Very good. And you chose quickly.
You have to have exit strategy.
Very good. Well, that's mostly the questions that I have. I was wondering if we had any questions from our audience for Steph.
Firstly, thank you for sharing with us. And my question is, you know, a lot of us are interested in climbing and flying and also all sorts of outdoor activities, but most of us were treated as an entertainment. But you chose it to be your own career. I want to know, why did you make this decision to make this your career, and what difficulties you have overcome for this? Thank you.
Sure. I don't feel I really made a decision to have these things be my career. It really evolved. But what happened for me was that I kind of straddled the line for a while between doing what I thought was like the responsible thing to do, which was to, you know, go through school, get a graduate degree, and you know, I enjoyed it. I had a good time doing that. But then there was kind of a decision point, which was the week in law school moment, where I felt that I should go to law school, but it wasn't where my passion was. And it was a really tough decision, but the decision I made at that time was that I should follow my passion, because I felt that if I did that, I would succeed a lot better than if I did something that I wasn't really passionate about. And I wasn't doing that to have a career in it. I was just doing it because it felt like, I guess, what I had to do. And then over the years, that developed into a career. And I think sometimes it works like that. You know, the thing you're passionate about may not look like a career, but if you're truly committed to it, over time, things change and things happen that weren't expected.
Steph, first of all, thanks for a great talk. I think for most people, you would be considered a pretty fearless person. What frightens you that would surprise most people?
I always laugh about that, because I'm scared all the time. I'm definitely not fearless. it's just more a question of figuring out how to manage yourself, because we're always scared all the time. And it's more about trying to figure out how to move forward and do a decent job when you're feeling those scared feelings. Because I think that's, if we can figure out how to do that, we have a lot more things that we can do. But I am scared of jumper cables. Yeah.
Can you elaborate on that?
Yeah, I don't like taking them off when you have to jump start the car. So I don't do that.
So fear of electricity then.
Yeah,
that's a
much.
Fair one, I think. Yeah. Do you have any other questions? Yeah.
So I see that you're pretty active on Instagram and in the outdoor community. There's a lot of climbers and people in the outdoor industry who have big presence there. So is that a good way for you to tell your stories and also to work with the sponsors as well? Can you tell us about that?
Yeah, so social media is, you know, obviously a huge part of all of our lives, and it's the way that we can connect and share with each other. And so for me, it's kind of fun. Like I think like most people, I really like taking pictures and sharing experiences and little stories, but kind of like I talked about before, that's the way that you can take something that inherently doesn't have value to others. You know, for example, you going for a run by yourself, that's not valuable to others. But if you go run by yourself and you can share something about that, either some tips about running or the feelings you had or a new place you've been, you know, suddenly that's valuable for others. And I think that's the power of social media.
I'm hoping that your repertoire doesn't involve free solo selfies or anything of this nature.
In-flight selfies.
Exactly. We have other questions?
Yes, we have one from our online audience. Mm. Levon asks, Steph, what keeps you going? What's your formula for self-motivation? And I would just add to that, do you ever have days when you wake up and you just say, oh gosh, I have to do this? I doubt it, but please elaborate.
Well, I mean, that's a good question, because, and this is something I've heard a lot from climbers, and I mean, I'm going to talk about this in terms of climbing or base jumping, but it's true of anything, I think. And I mean, I've been climbing for 26 years. That's a long time. And really, you know, flying for 10 years now, which is not as long, but becomes a long time. And it's all ebbs and flows, you know. I don't think there's anybody that wakes up every single day and is at the same exact excitement level about the same exact thing. So that's, I think that's partly why it's important to be diverse and have different interests, even within your sports, and just be willing to let some go on hiatus for a while and focus more on others. When I first started base jumping, I was so excited about it that for the first 3 years, I put almost all my attention into base jumping and just, you know, I climbed a little bit, but I was just charging with the base jumping. And then over time, the levels kind of came back. But there are definitely times where I'm not very excited about one style of climbing, so I just do another one. Or, you know, I'm not excited about training, so I don't. I think the worst thing you can do is kind of force it and feel like you have to be the same all the time, because that's just not how it is in life.
I guess I would ask, since you know, wingsuit flying and jumping was something new after having been a successful climber, what's the next thing for you? What's the next big challenge? Have you envisioned what that might be?
That's a hard question. I honestly, it's not so much that I became tired of climbing and that's why I started flying. It's more that I was just lucky to find these things that I really love. You know, I don't ever stop climbing, and I don't really see myself stopping flying. So I think I just happened to find these things that I'm very passionate about. So I'm not, you know, really in the market for another one or trying to let go of another one. I mean, I'm not going to say that won't happen, but it's just, just things I really like doing.
Do you have a question?
I have a question. Mm-hmm. Climbing and flying are I believe that there are some activities that require a lot of focus and preparation. I was wondering, in your spare time, what do you do to relax and just to let it go?
I really love trail running and also skate skiing, Nordic skiing, because those are two times when I don't have to be super careful and, you know, really attentive to risk, and I can just go and cruise, basically. So yeah, I do appreciate that, having some other things that I do where it doesn't have to be so focused and so careful. You know, that is the attraction, I think, of certain types of climbing and flying, but it's also nice to have things where you don't have to do that. And with climbing too, you know, there's so many types of climbing that are just pretty relaxing and fun, and I'll go out with my friends and, you know, we'll just be like chatting the whole time that we climb and not taking it very seriously. So there's definitely good to have times where it's not high risk.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Do we have other questions? No? No? Yeah, sure.
Very nice interview, by the way. I'm afraid of heights, right? You know, and even like when I go to a swimming pool, jumping from the board, not very high, it's very scary. It takes a lot to push yourself to actually jump. You know? And you know it's really safe, right? Mm-hmm. So, I mean, how do you overcome something like that? Is it just repetition or what is it?
Yeah, it is just repetition. And I think a lot of times we're sort of in a rush to get where we're trying to go, especially if we really don't like where we are in the moment. And I think we can feel this pressure to just kind of jump off the thing and not be scared anymore. But I know for myself, I found that it has to be really gradual. So whatever the thing is that I'm really scared, I'm not gonna be there quickly. I'm gonna have to really back up and do small things, you know, bit by bit by bit by bit. And then one day I'm gonna be comfortable doing the scary thing. And I think the most frustrating thing can be kind of looking at other people and watching people and thinking, well, they're not scared, it should be no big deal. But you have to just not do that. You have to focus on where you're at and just be willing to take those tiny little steps. And it does get you there faster, I think, than trying to rush it, even though it feels frustrating.
Very good. Well, Steph, thank you so much for talking with us.
Sure.
That's all the time that we have for today. Steph will be, she has a keynote at 5:30 p.m. this evening, so make sure and go to the auditorium for that. And thank you all for being here. Much appreciated. Best of luck.
Thanks.
Thank you.